Okay, good morning and welcome to Good Food Honors channel. We're here today with Lee Crosby, registered dietitian working with PCRM, the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine in Washington, D.C. And today we're going to talk all things whole food, plant-based. And this is really timely because Canada just released their new food guide, and that's focused a lot on whole food, plant-based nutrition. So welcome to our channel.
Delighted to be here. Thanks, Amy.
And so you work with patients, you help them to lose weight and to prevent and reverse chronic degenerative diseases, and you do that with a whole food plant-based diet, is that right?
I do, yeah. It's incredibly rewarding because people do, of course, they lose weight when they eat this way, but their health improves as well. It's just, I can't imagine a luckier place to be in terms of what I get to do with my time, yeah.
So let's focus on one of the major issues that people have, and a lot of people are concerned with being overweight and obese and how to effectively lose weight. And there are a lot of diets out there, a lot of information saying, you know, you can lose weight on this diet, you can lose weight on this diet, but you use a whole food plant-based diet, and you help your patients to lose weight safely and in a body positive way. So could you talk a little bit more about that?
Absolutely. Yeah. So when people go on a whole food plant-based diet, and we also use a lower fat approach, so we have people also set aside or minimize those added oils, it's wonderful because people can eat as much as they want. So a lot of diets, people aren't eating enough, they're getting cranky, they're actively trying to eat these tiny portions, and our bodies just aren't, we're just not wired that way. We're wired to eat until we're full. And so the great thing about a plant-based diet is that it's the kinds of foods that we're best adapted for. So when you eat them and you get full, that's great. Your body will on its own come down to a healthy weight. So it's almost like weight loss is just a side effect of eating these nourishing foods and supporting your body. So it's not, I don't have to ask anyone to do any restriction or counting their calories. It's just such a freeing way to eat that most people are delighted. And it's foods that people love. It's sweet potatoes. It's whole grain pasta. It's all the fruits and veggies you can imagine. It's tasty comfort food. It's chili. It's all these things that people want to eat anyway. So I basically get to tell people to eat delightful, delicious foods, and then they lose weight while other great things happen. So their blood pressure will typically come down. If they have high cholesterol, when they move those animal products and added oils off the plate, that will come down too. Their blood sugar tends to improve. So it's one of those, it's a win-win situation. People are losing weight, and unlike some of these other sort of faddish diets, the only side effects to a whole food plant-based diet are positive. They're improved health. So it almost makes my job too easy.
Foods that people are kind of afraid of and worried of, like pasta and, you know, potatoes. So one of the fad diets now is the keto diet. And I wonder, I know you did a presentation on this recently, and if you could talk a little bit about, you know, is this a healthy diet? Is it a safe way to lose weight? And will it work in the long term?
Yeah, so keto diets, spoiler alert, I find them very troubling because they are a very risky way to try and lose weight. So what a keto diet actually is, people will drastically reduce their carbohydrate intake and increase their fat intake. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes they're also increasing their protein intake, but the primary gist of the diet is very low carb, very high fat. And what that does is trigger something called ketosis. And that's basically when the body produces these little things called ketone bodies. And those are the alternate fuel source. So this is basically the body's emergency backup system, because your body really wants to run on glucose, or that sort of that comes from carbohydrates. It's blood sugar. Your body wants to run on that. If you take that away, it will start to make these ketone bodies as an alternate fuel. And so when people do sort of remove almost all carbohydrates from their diet, they do lose weight. But the key is they're not losing any more weight than they would on some other kind of diet that restricted calories to the same place, because it's not fun to eat, you know, just sort of butter and oils and meats, you know, wash, rinse, repeat. Like, that's not that's not a very thrilling way to eat. So most people will cut their calories down dramatically. The interesting thing is that when people start these diets, they'll see rapid weight loss at first, but their actual fat loss when they start this kind of diet, keto diet, slows down. So they've done, you know, there's some really incredible clinical trial where they put people on sort of a balanced diet versus a ketogenic diet and looked not just at their weight loss, but at their fat loss. And the weight loss is about the same, but the fat loss for keto diet actually slows. So it's more of a fluid issue. So, and then eventually it catches back up, but it's not, it's so even in the short term, you're not losing the kind of weight necessarily that you want to lose, but the risks and side effects I find very concerning. So, I mean, it almost sounds like one of those, you know, the drug commercials where side effects may include, and they list them about, you know, 1,000 miles an hour. But I mean, it's side effects may include the actual worsening of insulin resistance. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people will also go on these diets because they have diabetes. Mm-hmm. And they think, oh, I want to lower my blood sugar, right? Right. But so these diets do lower blood sugar because carbohydrate intake is almost eliminated. But right. The problem is it actually makes the underlying problem worse. And the underlying problem with diabetes is that people's insulin, which normally helps to lower their blood sugar, doesn't work very well. And ketogenic diets can actually make that insulin resistance or that insulin's ability to work worse. They actually did a study and they put young guys, I think they were in their mid to late 20s, and they put them on a ketogenic style diet for 3 days, and they could already start to see insulin resistance building in those gentlemen. And those are young, healthy guys. So really scary way to eat. I mean, the short-term side effects, we're talking nutrient deficiencies, constipation, that's kind of a no-brainer. Mm-hmm. There's when people transition onto keto diets, they get nausea, they get fatigue, they get headaches.
Right, the keto flu kind of.
Yes, they call it the keto flu. I'm like, why would you want to sign up for that? Obviously, their blood sugar, the effectiveness of insulin is not as good. It actually impairs their artery function. It raises their bad cholesterol. It impairs athletic performance. And honestly, it's really dangerous for heart health. And if you lose weight, but you have a heart attack and you're not there to enjoy, you know, the weight loss, you haven't gained anything. And then the long-term risks, I mean, these kinds of diets are associated with an increased risk of dying from all causes. That right there, check please.
Right.
That's enough. Increased risk of colon cancer, because most people are greatly increasing their red and processed meat intake on these. Higher exposure to pollutants. So you probably are aware that animal fat, so animals store these persistent pollutants in the environment in their fat. And then when people are eating these high fat animal products on a keto diet, they are getting a major dose of those pollutants when they do it. And this one really scares me. Women of reproductive age will often go on these keto diets to try and lose weight. The problem is that if they get pregnant while they are on these diets, their baby's having much higher risk, 30% higher risk of severe neural tube defects. So the problem is that most, you know, a good portion of women don't know they're pregnant for the first, you know, couple weeks or month. And that's when this kind of diet is most dangerous. So it really concerns me when younger women eat this way, because if they get pregnant while they're eating this way, it can have catastrophic effects for the baby. So, you know, there are just a couple reasons that I really, really have concerns about keto diets.
Yeah. And I think, you know, a lot of people are afraid of carbohydrates, but carbohydrates in general, that actually means plant foods.
Like, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep. I know. I don't understand the sort of carb phobia that's taken over. The only thing I can think is that maybe it's because people think of carbohydrates as sort of these processed, highly processed foods like donuts. And then they kind of, you know, generalize that out to like a sweet potato. But honestly, those two foods couldn't be more different. Right. So these whole plant carbohydrates, they're loaded up with fiber, and that really helps for weight loss because it actually triggers the stretch receptors in the stomach. So you feel full. So, and again, they also tend to have fewer calories. So animal foods and refined oils are really high in calories, but you just get this little bit of food in your stomach for those calories. So you don't get very full, whereas plant foods are giving you with the carbohydrate, which again, it's your body's preferred fuel. Let's be clear on that. There's a reason that endurance athletes will often, you know, carb load and those kinds of things. Like, that's what your muscles want to run on. But again, you're also going to get more satisfaction. You'll be fuller sooner with fewer calories because, again, these are the kinds of foods, you know, sweet potatoes and vegetables and white potatoes, which, fun fact, are loaded with fiber. They actually are decently high in protein and have magnesium and potassium and all these great things. So you're going to feel full while you're losing weight and improving your health. It's just, it's a win all over.
Yeah. And I wonder if you could talk a bit about, you know, a bit more about carbohydrates versus fats when it comes to satisfying the hunger drive, like how that mechanism works.
Right. So the biggest piece here that there are a couple, it's just volume of food and the fiber itself. Cause again, it's going to fill the stomach and we are designed to want to have a full stomach when we're done eating. Like, again, that's how we survived as a species. But when you're doing in terms of animal products, they tend to be high in fat and oils are literally pure fat. Now, why does that necessarily matter? Well, carbohydrates only actually have 4 calories per gram of carbohydrate. Fats, 9 calories per gram of fat. So you're getting twice as many calories in that same, you know, that same weight of food if you're eating fats. And one of the ways I like to sort of bring this home, and I use this honestly with every patient who doesn't understand when I say to them, okay, and we're also going to, you know, minimize those added oils, even olive oil, even, you know, avocado oil, the sort of healthier seeming oils. They're like, well, why would I do that? And it's just an interesting illustration that 2 tablespoons of olive oil, which most of us, at least I wouldn't have before I started eating whole food plant-based, would just, you know, dump that into a pan to saute your vegetables or put it on a salad, like no biggie, right?
Right. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So that actually has more calories than 2 quarter cup scoops of chocolate ice cream. Nobody would think of like scooping ice cream onto their salad, but because fat is literally the most concentrated source of calories on the planet and oils are straight fat with very few nutrients because all the good stuff has really been stripped away or almost all of it. It's just a really great reason to go ahead and ease those out of the diet along with the animal products because it really makes a difference in terms of weight and in terms of health. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's why carbohydrates are your friend, particularly those complex carbohydrates, the closer they are to the way they grow out of the ground. This isn't probably a surprise to anyone, but the better off you are. And those kinds of carbohydrates, the more the merrier.
Right. Yeah. And I guess they're sort of like a clean burning fuel too for the body.
They absolutely are. And again, they're not just packaged by themselves. Carbohydrates and plants come packaged with vitamins and minerals and protective phytochemicals. We're talking about cancer fighters. So there are laundry lists of those that I can go into, but there's sulforaphan and isothiocyanates that come from your cruciferous vegetables. Well, those are great in helping fight, you know, breast cancer. We have some pretty interesting data on that. You're getting all these amazing things along with the carbohydrates, the beta carotene and some of the other pigments, any bright colored pigments that come in these, you know, carbohydrate plant foods tend to be cancer fighting or antioxidants to help the body reduce inflammation and oxidation levels. So it really is carbohydrates in those forms. You want to eat as much of those as you until you're full. Like that's, they're good. And I know that it's frustrating because those are the foods that people are fearing the most are the very ones that could give them the best health outcomes.
Right. And I guess a lot of people also fear like it's really the starchy vegetables, but you talked about how the potato is actually pretty good for you and the sweet potato and then the whole grains. And that's something that people are avoiding because they think, and they've been kind of taught that, you know, when you eat a lot of these carbohydrates and you're eating too much of those carbohydrates, they're going to become fat in your body. So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about this de novo lipogenesis. And is that really the biggest thing that is causing this overweight and obesity trend that we're seeing, not just here in Canada, but kind of globally?
So the interesting thing there is that in terms of creating fat in the body, the fat that you consume from the diet is pretty much just a direct route. It goes straight into fat stores, any excess that you have. For carbohydrates, it has to go through a couple of steps first. And that is actually one of the nice things about eating a plant-based diet as well, is that you actually burn more calories after a plant-based meal than one that is not. So even if you are, if you're just plant-based and lounging around on the sofa after dinner, you're going to burn more calories than if you had had a meal that was sort of more in on, focused on animal food. So that's just a nice little side benefit for that. So that's one of the ways that, you know, this works best. Did that answer it at all? Oh, and I do want to circle back one more thing on the potatoes, is that I think people think of potatoes and those kinds of carbohydrates, again, as being, you know, things that make you gain weight because of the way we eat them. Most right. people aren't eating a baked potato with maybe, you know, some hummus on top or some, you know, smothered in chili. Like, what they're doing is eating it deep fried, so boiled in oil. That will make you gain weight. But a whole baked potato, when you're eating, you know, the skin and all of it, like, you're getting all those great nutrients that we talked about. And actually, they did a study, and they looked at 30 different foods, and potatoes, whole potatoes, came out at the top in terms of being satisfying.
Right.
So, yeah, but if you peel off the skin and then boil it in oil, yeah, you've taken a food that was very healthy and helped you feel full and turned it into one that can just pack on pounds because of the way it's prepared and the things that are added to it. So I think that's part of the disconnect between, you know, thinking something like a potato is bad for you, and really it's what we add to the potato that's bad for you.
Right. And I think you mentioned in one of your in your plant-based 101 course that a large baked white potato has more protein in it than a large egg.
Yeah, so a large egg has about 6 grams of protein, and a large baked potato has about 7.5 grams of protein. So I should say, yeah, a potato is not just carbohydrate.
Yeah.
It's also got, again, people don't think, if they would say, oh, I had, you know, potatoes at breakfast, they would be like, oh, I just had carbs. But really, they actually just had the same amount of protein as an egg.
Yeah, yeah.
Think for oatmeal. Oatmeal has about, it's a little less than an egg, but it's about similar. A bowl, just single serving of oatmeal, has about the same protein as an egg. So it's in there.
Yeah.
You can't get away from the protein. It'll find you.
And that's going to lead me actually to my next question, because a lot of people think, well, I'm very athletic and I'm very active. And so how effective is the whole food plant-based diet for athletes? And do they need to make special adjustments to the diet?
So a whole food plant-based diet is actually optimal for athletes. And there are a whole lot of reasons for this. Just first in terms of the nutrients, because I know people think athletes, they think protein, they're going to need more. So a whole food plant-based diet gets about 10-15% of its calories from protein. And that's sort of just optimal for overall functioning. Athletes do need more protein typically, but they also need more calories.
Mm-hmm.
So when they increase their intake of whole plant foods, they're also increasing their intake of protein. So that is typically more than sufficient to cover the needs of any sort of recreational athletes for sure. And often many of these sort of power athletes. Now, maybe if someone is really training at an elite level or they're trying to build, you know, large amounts of muscle mass, they might need more protein for sure, but it's easily obtained from plant foods. You eat a couple more servings of beans a day, or you have an extra, you know, serving of tofu. It's not a complicated thing to get that extra protein in if it's needed, but honestly, most athletes don't need it. And there are so many advantages to eating plant-based for athletic performance that have nothing to do with the sort of, you know, how much protein is in the diet. But I mean, so a couple of different things. Physicians Committee actually just worked on a review paper looking at these and published it. And because the heart is what pumps blood to all the muscles and mm-hmm. is key, absolutely key to even, you know, even sort of weightlifting, but also particularly to endurance sports, a plant-based diet very much promotes heart health. Mm-hmm. So people who are on a plant-based diet have a much lower risk of having a heart attack. And people think, well, it's okay because I'm healthy, I'm athletic, you know, I don't have heart disease. A study in 2017 found that actually about 44% of middle-aged and older endurance cyclists and runners, these are super fit people, had coronary plaques. So those are little plaques that are partly blocking the vessels that feed the heart that bring oxygen and nutrients to the heart. Well, that's, you know, we definitely need to be doing as much of bringing oxygen and nutrients to the heart as you can if you need to perform. So going on a plant-based diet, and in fact, a low-fat vegetarian or vegan diet has actually been shown in some people to reverse heart disease. So it very much is important for heart health, which is key to performance. Plant-based diets are associated with less inflammation. Mm-hmm. So after a tough workout, you're going to have increased inflammation in the body. Plant-based foods are anti-inflammatory. Things like meat tend to be pro-inflammatory. And actually, plant-based diets help blood flow more easily too. Are you aware of this?
Yeah, I think, yeah, I know about the high-fat meals like causing the sludging and the sticking, but tell us a bit about that.
Yeah, so you're absolutely right. A single meal that's high in fat and saturated fat can basically sludge up your blood, just like you said, for hours after you eat it. But there's also an interesting point that research is showing that people who are on sort of these sort of purely plant-based diets, their blood just flows better naturally anyway. And that's compared with people who are even eating meat like once a week. So wow. it really is a significant difference. And also the flexibility of your artery is important because you need it to be able to open up. If you need more blood flow to your muscles, you need those arteries to be able to expand a little bit to bring that blood in. And people who are on plant-based diets have better artery function. So their arteries are better able to expand when they need to. So that's another reason. I mean, there are so many, but those are sort of some of the key reasons that not only is this diet okay for athletes, it's actually optimal for performance.
Right. And I think there's some really great athletes who are becoming whole food plant-based because it improves their performance so much. Even in the NFL, which is funny because a lot of people think, well, to be manly and to have, you know, strength, you need to eat meat and you need to get your protein. But right. you're saying it's very damaging to the body. And as long as you get enough calories, you're going to get enough protein. I think it was Nathan Pritikin who said that it's virtually impossible to get a protein deficiency unless you're not getting enough calories.
Yeah, I joke that we have a plate guide here at Physicians Committee, and it's got whole grains and fruits and vegetables and legumes, so beans, peas, and lentils. And people are like, but where do you get your protein? And I just point to every single group, and it is everywhere. You literally cannot escape protein on a whole food plant-based diet. There's even small amounts in a piece of fruit. You know, a piece of fruit will have a gram or two of protein, and it just goes way up from there with the other food. So it's okay. Like, people don't think about, oh, I got to eat my meat to get my protein. Well, where did that cow get its protein?
Right.
You know, like, oh, wait a minute. So yeah, it absolutely. And the things that come with meat, like red meat, it's got heme iron. I mean, that can actually sort of cause internal rusting. It's pro-oxidant, and you want things that are antioxidant. So yeah, it really does, and it speeds recovery time for people. Mm-hmm. So they're able to train more and train more effectively. So, oh yeah, power athletes, it's just across so many different sports, more and more people are shifting to this because they're getting better results.
Right. And I think like one of the benefits, like going back to the losing weight, and when you change to this diet, like it affects your metabolism, it affects your energy level. So people who happen to be overweight or feeling unwell, like they switch to this diet, and beforehand, you don't realize how good you're going to feel.
Right.
But afterwards, you know, you'll have a more energy, and then you'll want to be more active just naturally.
Yeah, it really is fantastic how that happens. And there are just so many things in foods, like whole plant foods, that can do that. One of my favorites is that, so I'm guessing you're familiar with folate. Is that?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. So one of the B vitamins, it tends to be found in dark leafy greens, foliage, hence the name folate, and also beans. And that's actually one of the building blocks of serotonin. Mm-hmm. Have you heard of that? Yeah. So serotonin is that feel-good neurotransmitter. And if you don't have enough folate, you're not going to be able to make enough serotonin. I mean, the very medications that we use to treat depression are medications that increase serotonin activity in the body. Or we can just, it's not, or some people certainly do need medication, but why not go ahead and give your body the building blocks it needs to make the stuff that makes you feel good?
And I think it's like 90% is produced in the gut. I think I came across that in one of the, there was a presentation from a gastroenterologist.
Oh, serotonin. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is fantastic because that can touch on, like, we can go into the microbiome and all that, and that's a huge.
Oh gosh. Yeah, that'll be a whole other. That'll be a whole other.
And we're still discovering more about it, so it's like endless. But yeah. So what about people who think, like, I just need to eat meat, or say, how different do diets need to be? How personalized do they need to be? And let's probably go with that one first, and then we'll talk about, like, people who think that they need to eat meat because when they stop, they don't feel well.
So oftentimes, if people are switching to a plant-based diet and they don't feel well, I'll go after one of the first things is that oftentimes they're not eating enough food. End of story. Because if you're eating the same amount of food that you ate before, you're going to be getting a lot fewer calories. So that's sort of the number one thing when people are like, oh, well, I don't feel awesome. Well, then I sort of go back and look at, well, what are you eating and how much? And if they're eating the same size portions, a lot of times they're like, oh, I don't have energy. I'm like, you're not eating enough food. So it's so great that I get to tell people who are trying to lose weight, like, eat more.
Yeah.
So that's a key in terms of, like, I need meat. I just haven't seen data anywhere that would support that. The one thing that people on a plant-based diet absolutely do need to supplement is vitamin B12. I want to make sure that that's in there. That you do need to get from a supplement. It's in a lot of fortified foods as well. But in terms of, like, I need to eat meat, it's like, no, you can get those nutrients that you're getting in meat from a safer source if you're doing it in a plant-based way.
Right. And I think it was Dr. Clapper who was talking about, like, some people felt the need to eat meat, and he had this presented a theory that because when you ingest meat, you're also taking in these non-essential amino acids like carnitine and creatine, and that it would downregulate the genes that would produce the enzymes for you to produce those amino acids yourself in your body.
Interesting.
So there's kind of, but it's almost like a food addiction. So you get these withdrawal symptoms, and then after some time with the food you're eating, you'll be able to upregulate those genes again.
But I've actually not heard that, but it makes sense. It certainly makes sense.
And I know I've met, when I was in India, there was a Tibetan monk, and he had, he came from Tibet, and so their diet had, like, some meat and a lot of yak milk and yak butter.
Right.
And then in India, all of their monasteries are vegetarian, and he felt really sick, so they told him he needed to eat meat. Oh. And he's a very slim, very fit-looking person. But it could be, you know, something that if you grow up on it from birth, that you just aren't able to, or you are able to, but you've down-regulated those genes.
Yeah, most of the time, if people will just give it a little bit of time, they'll feel better. The other piece here is that if people are doing this and they've been eating a lot more and they lose weight rapidly, mm-hmm. that can also, we talked about how animals will build up those sort of persistent organic pollutants. So those things
right.
like pesticides in the environment, they build them up and they store them in their fat. They're fat soluble. And so if you do switch to a plant-based diet and you lose weight rapidly, your body's going to be mobilizing its own fat stores. And when it does that, it will also release some of those built up, you know, again, we call them persistent organic pollutants, which right. means that your liver is going to have to process them so you can get rid of them. And that might make you feel a little lousier. There's not a lot of strong data on that, but that's just that's my own personal hypothesis on one of the reasons that people may not feel great, even though really good things are happening in their body.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think some of, like, the whole food plant-based foods that have been mentioned that could help with that bind with toxins. So if you're detoxifying, are like the fiber, and then you get like green leafy vegetables seem to be a really great food to have if you're detoxing and a lot of stuff is coming out. But
right.
I wanted to say, when you were talking about the chemicals that people are exposed to from animal fats, I believe it was Dr. Michael Greger in his book, How Not to Diet, was saying that 95% of our exposure to chemical pollutants is actually from ingesting animal fat, which is, you know, quite surprising because most people try to avoid things like, you know, even cigarette smoke or asbestos, but then you're eating animal fat and you actually store that in your own fat stores.
Yeah, I do have a lot of people who are, they are afraid to eat conventional produce, but then they also eat meat. And it's like, well, the exposure you would have from conventional produce is so much smaller than what you would get from eating meat products. And there's so many benefits to eating the produce. It's just, yeah, I oftentimes will have to give people reassurance that, well, sure, yeah, organic is great, but it can be really expensive, and conventional produce is still so much safer for you and has so many benefits to it, that especially if you're just going to go eat a piece of meat, like, you know, there's a disconnect for sure, that's the way that biology works. And yet there it is.
Yeah. And I guess, you know, it's the fruit synergy thing too. Like, even if you have a bit of pesticide on your fruit, it's got all of these protective components, which yep. is really great to have anyways.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's never just, we do get very sort of reductionist and want to look at individual pieces, but there is synergy when you're eating. Again, these are the foods that we're sort of best adapted to eat. Like, certainly our bodies are capable of eating meat, obviously, but we're really optimized for these whole plant foods and the things that are in them. And when you don't have them, there are actually issues with that. So people, when they say, oh, you eat plant-based or you're vegan or whatever, like, where do you get your protein? I'm like, well, where are you getting all your fiber and your folate and your vitamin C? I mean, those are the things we actually really need to worry about. The protein takes care of itself.
Yeah. And so I'd like to move on to